The Lunar New Year is a time of celebration. In Chinatown, they're feasting on Tasmanian rock lobster. China used to be the biggest market for this delicacy before a trade stoush that smashed Australian businesses.
Only last night I had a fisherman on the phone crying to me, you know, wondering how he's going to pay his bills, and yeah, it's only the start, I think.
For the best part of a year, China's trade sanctions have hit industry after industry.
This was massive. This was the end of our export to China.
The market's actually dropped to zero.
We're all in survival mode. We're doing the best we can. That's all we can do.
The dispute is about far more than trade.
The trade barriers that China imposed on Australia in 2020 are cases of economic coercion.
China is trying to coerce Australia into supporting, essentially, China's interests.
There's a fierce debate about how to respond.
We're not going to lay down in a fetal position and get kicked to death.
I just do wonder how many times we might choose to poke the dragon before the dragon turns back and blows fire at us in a pretty painful way.
Tonight on Four Corners, we investigate China's trade sanctions against Australia. We'll meet the Australian business people hit hard by China's bans and tariffs. And we'll explore whether Beijing is using trade as a weapon in a campaign of political coercion.
China has followed through on its threat to whack crippling tariffs on Australian barley, a move that will further inflame tensions between the two nations. The 80% tariff will be in place for 5 years, a decision that could cost Australian farmers hundreds of millions of dollars.
The Salt Lake country of southern WA is a long way from Canberra and a world away from Beijing. But farmers here have found themselves on the front line of a trade war with China. It's a windswept landscape, and it may not look like a food bowl, but it's rich terrain for grain.
In this particular area, you know, the Lakes area of Western Australia, barley is one of our main cash crops. I mean, it probably accounts for 50% of the grain that's grown here in Western Australia.
Doug Smith heads the industry association WA Grains Group. Until last year, he was riding a barley boom driven by surging Chinese demand. At its peak, China was buying more than $1 billion worth of Australian barley a year.
We were sort of exporting somewhere around 6 million tonne of barley to China. We're talking Australia-wide here. I think Western Australia alone was exporting somewhere around 3.5 million tonne. So, you know, we've forsaken all the other markets basically because it was all we could do to produce enough to satisfy the Chinese market.
But the risk of banking on China hit home last May when it imposed a crippling 80% tariff on the industry.
All of a sudden, here it was, and this wasn't, you know, the $10 or $15 a tonne that the industry thought might have been imposed on us. This was massive. This was the end of our export to China.
To make matters worse, the announcement of China's decision came when the new season's crops were already in the ground.
If they had have made the announcement of that level of tariff in, oh, let's say, February, it would have been quite easy for growers to say, well, look, we're not going to grow as much barley. But to wait until after, for all intentional purposes, a lot of the Australian barley crop was planted, yeah, was it strategic? I would think so.
It was a bitter blow. After exhaustive efforts to refute China's allegations that Australia was dumping barley at below the cost of production onto the Chinese market.
The timelines that was put on the industry to respond were so short, it was incredible. And the detail that they were looking for basically financial detail back down to grower level.
Doug Smith's home is a meeting point for growers caught up in the China tensions. Among them, his friends Doug and Debbie Clark. They think China's move is calculated.
They've worked out very well to target the industries that cause the least amount of problems in their country, so it doesn't shut down their woolen mills, so the wool keeps going, the iron ore. So they're strategically picking off Australia, where it has the least impact on their economy.
Debbie, how do you feel about this?
Well, it is a bit annoying, but you can't waste energy on being angry or annoyed when you cannot influence a foreign government.
I mean, we can't do trade at any cost. I mean, we've got to uphold, you know, our principles and the principles of the Australian way. We don't want to lay down in a fetal position and get kicked to death. We need to stand up and fight back.
Australia is challenging China's tariff at the World Trade Organization.
It might take 1 or 2 years for us to resolve it, but the principle of it is incredibly important. We want to go to the umpire and we want to get a decision from the umpire whether the actions being taken are right or not. If we don't have organisations like the World Trade Organization for us to go to, then it's basically the rule of the jungle.
Barley was the start of a slew of trade allegations and sanctions that followed a souring of relations between Canberra and Beijing.
The Foreign Minister, Maurice Payne, is refusing to be drawn on whether she trusts China over its handling of the coronavirus pandemic.
Australia's call for a COVID inquiry appeared to be a catalyst.
A Chinese analyst has described the Foreign Minister Maurice Payne's calls for an independent inquiry into the origins of the coronavirus outbreak and the global response as deplorable.
The reality is the tensions are deep and longer standing.
It's a big mistake to think that this is simply because of the way the Australian government responded to the pandemic, the way the Australian government very bluntly called for an international investigation into the origins of COVID-19. If it wasn't that, it would have been something else. There's been an accumulation of friction points between Australia and China, I'd say at least over the past 5 years, that go to fundamental differences of interests and of political values.
If you look at the downward trend in political relations, it actually goes back, I think, to a high point of about 2014. And there are a number of actions on both sides of both the Chinese and Australian government that signal a pretty consistent downward trajectory, and there's not a lot of reason to think that that's going to turn around.
China set out its grievances in a document leaked to the media last year. They included banning Chinese telco Huawei from building Australia's 5G network, Australia's foreign interference laws, the call for an independent inquiry into COVID-19, Australia's incessant wanton interference in China's Xinjiang, Hong Kong and Taiwan affairs, and antagonistic media reports that were poisoning the atmosphere of bilateral relations. The reporter who was handed the document by an embassy official had no doubt about China's agenda.
I was very clear in asking her, what does this mean in the context of the trade issues we'd seen with beef and wine and barley and the like? And she said, it's all linked. She looked at me and she said, if you make China the enemy, China will be the enemy.
On the same day, China's powerful foreign ministry echoed key grievances in answer to a question about the trade dispute.
澳方公然违反国际关系基本准则，屡屡在涉港、涉疆、涉台等涉及中国核心利益问题上采取错误言行。
Many of these points go to the independent policy choices of the Australian government in a democratic system, including choices to do with legislation, with the funding of think tanks, with the freedom of the Australian media, with diplomatic positions Australia takes in the international system. So it's simply untenable for any Australian government to concede on those points. And I fear that in a way, the Chinese government has painted itself into a corner.
In the same month that China effectively banned Australian barley, another rural export was hit.
Four Australian abattoirs have been banned from selling red meat into China. One of the meatworks is in Casino in northern New South Wales, while three are based in Queensland.
When we found out, it was all hands to the pump exceptionally quickly. I certainly was on the phone for basically 72 hours. Just because of the sheer shock of this coming in, it was without warning.
Casino is the heart of the Northern Rivers beef belt and home to the Northern Cooperative Meat Company, one of the abattoirs suspended by China. It was target for alleged labelling errors on some cartons of beef.
In the past, those sort of problems have been either ignored by China or they've been dealt with on an informal basis, industry to industry, people to people. But in the current environment, China's become particularly formal about it with very low tolerances. So that is their pretext to stop that trade.
...10% of the Casino Meatworks business was lost with the China suspension.
What do you reckon about this situation with China?
Oh, look, I'm really focused on doing what I've got to do in relation to China, and that is I've got to make sure my product leaves here that's acceptable to markets all over the world, and that includes China. I don't really listen to any of the outside noise because I can't control it.
Australian abattoirs were suspended for similar issues in 2017, but the matter was resolved in 3 months. This time, close to a year on, there's no resolution and no indication of when the suspensions might be lifted.
Oh, look, hard to tell, but I'm comfortable we're closer to getting back in than we were yesterday.
It doesn't help that Chinese officials won't pick up the phone.
It is exceptionally frustrating. And that's the concerning part for us as an industry, because our dialogue is what makes us operate effectively well in trade. And if that dialogue's not there, then it's nigh on impossible to try and then fix some of these issues.
When Australia's new trade minister, Dan Tehan, tried to engage his counterpart in China, he was also met with silence.
I wrote to him in the middle of January. It was a very extensive letter. It set out why it was so important for us to be able to have a ministerial dialogue.
What signal do you read into the lack of reply?
I'm not quite sure. I'm a little puzzled by it, because I think the best thing that all countries can do is maintain dialogue. If you've got differences, the best thing you can do is engage and make sure you can work through them. So my hope is that over time that's where we'll get to.
Economist and China expert Scott Waldron grew up on the land in beef country. His family's property in the Tweed Valley of northern New South Wales sends its cattle to the co-op at Casino.
Hey cattle, hey cattle. Hey cattle, congos.
Scott Waldron has also lived and researched extensively in China, is fluent in Mandarin, and well placed to analyse China's trade claims.
The trade barriers that China imposed on Australia in 2020 are cases of economic coercion. And the intent is for China to change Australian policy, including on issues of the South China Sea, Hong Kong, Xinjiang, Huawei, and foreign interference.
On his reading, the trade sanctions flowed from demands by China's Communist Party for retaliation against any perceived threats or criticism of China.
Xi Jinping has instructed China to resolutely defend against any internal or external threat to the Communist Party. And so that so-called battle stance has become embedded within the party, within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and its wolf warrior diplomacy, and down into economic units, including the Ministry of Commerce, the state administrations of customs and quarantine. So if you're a mid-level official in one of those economic departments, your incentive, the way that you get ahead, is to appeal to that spirit.
Economic coercion is a very deliberate activity to try and make the Australian government change its policy stance. It's certainly not clear that that's what Beijing has set out to do, and nor is it clear that they've achieved that goal. But I think what we can say is that by the time you've got 14, 15 sectors on the chopping block, whether you call it coercion or something else, it is quite clear that Beijing is sending a signal, and it looks very much like punishment to me.
The wine industry was the next target.
Australia's billion-dollar wine exports to China are under threat. Is it economic coercion as relations languish?
In August last year, China began an investigation of Australian wine, claiming it was being dumped at artificially low prices on the Chinese market. No region was more exposed than the Barossa Valley in South Australia.
We had inklings all the way along, probably for at least 6 months beforehand, that the Chinese were going to introduce a tariff. We had fairly good intel.
At Hamish Seabrook's family vineyard, the harvest is underway before dawn.
I've been here for more than 30 years and I love the Barossa, it's home.
For years, his main business has been Red Kangaroo. Hamish started the venture with a business partner a decade ago, making wine for China.
I think our first container went November 2011. We followed that up by a quick trip to China and met some more distributors over there. It's just grown from strength to strength from year to year.
After China began its dumping investigation, the company decided to cooperate and open the books to its officials.
We've got nothing to hide. We certainly had nothing to hide. Everything we do is transparent. We just figured, if we submit and be a part of this place where we can open up what we do, maybe the Chinese will look favourably when they do introduce tariff.
China imposed massive tariffs on the wine industry, up to 212%. They're in place for 5 years. Red Kangaroo copped a slightly reduced rate, but more than enough to smash the business. So your venture, Red Kangaroo, is effectively dead?
It's fair to say.
The section back there, this is all the dry goods.
This is the fallout from China's trade war.
So it's a vast warehouse. You certainly get lost in here.
Pallets of wine meant for China, now gathering dust.
How many bottles do you have stored here?
We've got 60,000 bottles, all burning a big old hole in our bank account at the moment.
Storing the wine has cost tens of thousands of dollars.
What's worse, we had containers of wine on the water, ready to land. And to be honest, we had no idea what was going to happen to those wines, whether they were going to be accepted or not.
The wine spent nearly 5 months in customs being tested for additives the winemakers don't even use.
Who's to blame for this? I could honestly say that I feel that maybe the Australian government could have done more to open up dialogue earlier. I feel that the Chinese government could have done more to accept dialogue earlier. I feel that we're just really a pawn in their political game.
Historic Chateau Tanunda looks out over the fields where the first Barossa vines were planted in the 1840s. In happier times, the Chateau's wines were enjoyed at the highest level.
This was at the G20 summit in Brisbane in 2014, where our 100-year-old Semillon was chosen as one of the showcase wines of Australia.
So you had the President of America and the President of China drinking your wine.
And the President of Chateau Tanunda as well. It was very, very important.
Despite submitting to a forensic investigation by Chinese officials, Chateau Tanunda received a prohibitive tariff, and the timing in the lead-up to the Chinese New Year sales maximised the pain.
So this is the year of the ox for 2021. Unfortunately for us, of course, we came into all these tariffs and everything was sort of closed down. So
it's a long game. Our wine industry is not a marathon. It's not even a double marathon, it's a treble marathon. And you just got to keep going.
China accounted for 40% of Australia's wine exports.
It's been a devastating impact. So once the tariffs were introduced, we found that the markets actually dropped to zero. We've got to find a new home for $1.1 billion worth of wine.
There's been significant Chinese investment in the Australian wine industry, especially in the Barossa. And one of the ironies of China's effective ban is it's hitting Chinese nationals, Chinese expats and Chinese investors pretty hard. Last year, 768,000 bottles of wine from Chinese-owned vineyards in this region were shipped offshore to China. This year, that's fallen to next to nothing. The grapevines of orchid wines are nestled on the slopes above the valley.
So we have roughly about 8 tons of the Shiraz we'll be harvesting from the vineyard in this year, and about 4 tons of the Cabernet, which is being harvested on the back of the house. So,
yeah. Jason Zhao came to Australia to study wine in 2005. He worked for two wineries before starting his own business. Nearly all his wine was going to China before the tariff cut it dead.
Our business dropped for 95%.
95%?
95%, because we only have another 5% for selling the bulk wine to UK market and the US market, which is not be helping us for keep doing the business.
Hi,
Jason's parents migrated to Australia to join their son and his family.
My parents, they still encourage me, and they say if you work hard, you do the right things, and one day the things will come back. Just pull your heads down and work hard. Just keep working.
Scott Waldron has read and analysed China's allegations against wine and other industries in the original Mandarin.
The Chinese case against the Australian wine industry is even more spurious than it is for the case of barley. So in the case of wine, China is arguing that Australia dumped wine into China at below normal price. The price of Australian wine exported to China is higher than all other countries, than France or Chile or Spain. And it's many times higher than the price of Chinese domestic wine.
As the wine industry dealt with the tariff, sanctions had already moved from farming to mining.
Relations with China and the Australian economy along the way may have suffered another hammer blow, with unconfirmed reports that Beijing has suspended lucrative imports of Australian coal.
In October, Australian producers were told that coal yet to clear customs would not be allowed into China. By then, there was already a queue of vessels blocked from unloading Australian coal.
They're lined up there in China for their political reasons, are holding them to ransom to make a point to Australia. And they can't leave to crew change because they lose their spot in the waiting list and the insurance that protects them.
At one stage, 77 ships were stranded off China, with crews effectively imprisoned on the boats.
We are physically and mentally exhausted. We are scared that because of this trade issue, this trade war, God knows when we are going to reach home.
It's an extraordinary tale of a lot of depression. They're away from their families, the Filipinos and Indians, developing countries and hit hard by COVID. I mean, it is layer on layer on layer of human tragedy.
Australia's lucrative lobster exports could be the next target in the growing trade spat with China. Tons of them are sitting at airports across China. The federal government understands they're being inspected for traces of minerals and metals.
At Margate, south of Hobart in Tasmania, the crew of the Bold Contender are readying the lobster trawler for one more voyage. It's last for a while. No industry has suffered more from the China trade sanctions than this one.
We're just heading into Bull Bay, back of Bruny Island, to check our lobster pots this morning.
How many you got there?
We've got 50.
Brendan Taylor has made the journey countless times.
27 years I've been involved in the rock lobster industry in Tasmania. I was a deckhand for a very long time, and I've been running our family business with the Bold Contender for 13 years. And this is the toughest time I've ever seen.
Until 6 months ago, the lobster caught here would have been going to China. Now it's hardly worth it. Without China, a catch that used to fetch $80 a kilo is getting as little as $25. What's happened to your revenue?
We're down 75% to 80% right now. It's terrible. I leased the boat, I've got a crew to look after. We've got three families what live off my family business. And at the moment, I don't see a future for us. I'm worried about other people. I'm worried about everything. You have sleepless nights. The stress is just through the roof.
What about your mates in the industry?
This is what I'm scared of the most. I've got a lot of mates what have just come in the last 5, 10 years. The reality is, I don't think they'll be here in 6 months.
There are about 150 boats in the Tasmanian fleet, and fears a third will be forced out.
I owe the bank over $1 million. Yep. And this is probably the worst pill I've got to swallow at the moment. I've invested heavily in the industry, and at the moment, what is it worth? It'd be like you buying a house for $1 million, and next minute someone tells you it's worth $200,000. It's not good.
He's battled to maintain his mental health.
Yeah, I have. I've been in tears myself. I even rang up one of the support centres, had a talk to a guy, and I've worked through it. I've learnt now not to take at home, especially with young kids and that. I mean, it's all hard on the whole family, you know, the wife, the kids. I've got a son that wants to be a fisherman, take after me. Where's the future at the moment? There isn't one. There isn't one.
This is where the lobsters from the Bold Contender go.
So we've got about 7,000 kilos in here, about 10,000 animals.
That's a lot of animals.
It is a lot of animals, and we handle every one of them, check them for quality.
Industry veteran Michael Blake runs the plant near Hobart Airport. He's been visiting China since he was 19 and knows the market intimately.
I love the place, to be honest, and I love the people. There's a very long history with China with our species of lobster. It's the most sought-after species of lobster in the world. It's red. Its name translates to dragon in Chinese. So it's a very big stature product over there.
Last November, China began testing Australian lobster for cadmium. After officials claimed they'd found the toxic heavy metal in a cargo of live lobster, tons of the creatures were left stranded on the tarmac, and exports shut down.
Well, I was extremely surprised. Southern rock lobster, being a cold water species, would have cadmium levels in them. So we investigated into it more, and we found that the lobsters they'd tested come from northern Australia.
Four Corners understands testing by government agencies has found no evidence of contamination in southern rock lobster that would justify China's action.
And there was nowhere else in the world anything like it. It was probably our top five marketplaces were within China, and now we don't have any of them.
This is the market now. On a sunny weekend, Michael Blake is delivering to a van selling lobster rolls at a winery.
Hey, Sheree. Got some more crays for you.
Excellent, thank you very much.
That'll be enough, you think?
Locals have rallied to support the industry, but that can only do so much.
It's going to be tough. I feel a bit more like a councillor than I do a fish processor at the moment. I'm getting phone calls every day. Fishermen don't even sell to me, asking me what's going on. Can I take their fish? I can't because I struggle to look after our own. Only last night I had a fisherman on the phone crying to me, you know, wondering how he's going to pay his bills. And yeah, it's only the start, I think.
Michael Blake knows people who think the government should appease China for the sake of trade. He's not one of them.
I understand where they're coming from, but unfortunately I think for the for our democracy, for our way of life, for everything that we, you know, hold dear to ourselves about Australia, whether it was China or another country, I think Australia needs to stand up for itself.
The way the industry has engaged with me, those affected industries, it has been really humbling. That some of those industries are hurting quite significantly, but they understand that Australia's sovereignty is incredibly important, that we have to pursue our national interests in a country-agnostic way. They've sought to put the national interests before their own self-interests, and I'd like to thank them for that.
There's no doubt the toll on industries like lobster and wine is terrible. Yet the reality is China's sanctions have only had a minor impact on the overall economy. Coal that would have gone to China has been sold to other countries. Even barley's found new markets. And ironically, despite the punishment, Australia's trade with China actually increased last year.
It's fascinating that during the year that China was punishing Australia economically through all sorts of levers, the overall size of Australian exports to China actually grew because of the iron ore price and the sheer scale of our iron ore exports and China's demand.
From January 2021, we had a $10 billion surplus, which is the highest on record. So the resilience of our economy has stood up incredibly well.
Australia's economy has been shored up by iron ore. It's by far Australia's biggest export, and it's conspicuously absent from the trade sanctions. For now, China has little choice but to satisfy its appetite for the mineral from the mines of Australia's northwest. But Australia may not be able to rely on that trade in coming years.
China is actively seeking to diversify the imports of key strategic products, including iron ore.
I don't think we can any longer expect that iron ore is going to form the mainstay of the Australian economy and that Chinese demand for that is going to keep us propped up. They are busily trying to diversify their needs away from Australia. They're looking at markets in Africa, in Papua New Guinea, in Brazil.
Economist Jane Golley heads the Australian Centre on China and the World at ANU. She's part of a crucial policy debate about how to handle China. Professor Golley is not naive about the nature of the leadership in Beijing.
The shift that China has made under Xi Jinping has been deeply worrying for lots of us, and that's changed my own positioning on how I think about all sorts of things to do with the Australia-China relationship.
But she thinks Australia has the balance between national security and the economy wrong. In her view, Australia should tone down its rhetoric and consciously steer a middle path between the US and China.
There really does seem to be this perception that if the Australian government softens its stance at all towards China, that we'll be perceived as weak. I don't think necessarily that being a little bit kinder, treading a little bit more softly is necessarily a sign of weakness. If you look at the relative economic strength of the two countries, I do come back to this analogy of the big, strong, tough kid in the playground. How many times do you poke that kid and make fun of them as they see it before they turn around and give you a big whack in the face?
Don't you stand up to bullies, though?
I don't think it always makes good sense, does it? I don't like black eyes.
Across the ANU campus, former diplomat and intelligence analyst Rory Medcalf sees it very differently.
Every concession that Australia makes will be pocketed by the Chinese government and will set a precedent for our own future and for the future of other countries.
While exports to China have delivered an economic boom, Australia's reliance on the China trade has left the nation vulnerable.
I think this rude awakening came that it was not a sustainable approach for Australia to rely so deeply on the economy and the political system of the People's Republic of China, while at the same time preserving our interests, values and identity as a multicultural liberal democracy.
I think we've got all our eggs in one basket on a number of fronts, and I think that's a dangerous situation for any industry to be in.
What we have to do is be making sure we've always got a diversified suite of countries that we can export to, because that's the best way that we can secure our businesses, especially those that are heavily reliant on commodity trades.
I don't think anyone would question that diversification away from the Chinese market makes really good sense in theory, and particularly if we're going to see more examples of them targeting key sectors and inflicting damage on them. The question is, who can we diversify to?
Australia has shown remarkable resilience in the face of the economic pressure, but producers still fear retaliation. For all those who've spoken to us, there are far more unwilling to speak out. They're afraid of reprisals if they offend China. And there are others still who don't want to say how much business they're doing with China, fearing a backlash at home. That's the level of tension this situation has caused. As we travelled around the country, speaking to people hit by China's sanctions, the list of industries kept growing. Timber, cotton, copper, coral trout, and there may be more pain to come.
Australia is the perfect country for them to target because of our dependency on them and because we've been so vocal about the things that we don't like them doing. I think that means they're using us as an example to show the rest of the world just what will happen to your economy if you continue to poke the dragon.
It has backfired so far on China in that Australian policy positions are not shifting. Australian public opinion is turning against China and the Chinese Communist Party. And the rest of the world is watching this situation and thinking, what can they do to prepare themselves against this kind of onslaught against their own values and interests? In every way, then, I think the Chinese coercion against Australia so far is not working. These are good reasons for Australia to hold its ground. Don't poke the dragon, don't be gratuitous, but don't back down either.